Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. In the wrong direction, authorities attempt a course correction in their pandemic response as COVID-19's daily death toll tops 1,000 in the U.S. for the first time since May. Then, rising tensions. The U.S. orders a Chinese consulate in Houston closed, alleging theft of data and intellectual property. Plus, the hunt for a vaccine as medical developers race against the clock. Questions remain about the cost and delivery of an eventual prevention. And America addicted. The pandemic causes a dramatic rise in overdoses as people struggling with addiction lose access to treatment.
Addiction is a disease of isolation, and no one chooses to have addiction any more so than someone chooses to have diabetes or multiple sclerosis.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, Johnson & Johnson, financial services firm Raymond James.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at Lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
More deaths, more infections, and more restrictions. The spread of the coronavirus pandemic shows no sign of easing, and officials are scrambling to respond. Stephanie Tsai begins our coverage.
The summer surge of infections is now fueling a surge in deaths, more than 1,000 over 24 hours for the first time in weeks. As of today, California leads the nation in confirmed infections, with state officials hoping they can cope.
I think we all look at our initial strategy of trying to be prepared for a number of days with high number of cases and ensuring that we have the surge capacity in our hospital system.
In Texas, more than 500 women at a federal medical prison in Fort Worth have tested positive, one of the largest prison outbreaks to date. Elsewhere, Washington, D.C., Ohio, and Minnesota joined the growing list of governments issuing mandatory mask orders. And the surge has forced more schools that plan to reopen in the fall to opt for remote instruction instead. All of this is testing delays and shortages in personal protective equipment are again growing acute. At a House hearing in Washington today, the head of the Federal Emergency Management Agency, Pete Gaynor, acknowledged shortcomings.
The majority of PPE is made offshore, China, Malaysia, Vietnam. This is a national security issue, PPE, and we've seen how critical that is to protecting lives and minimizing suffering. So we are on a path to increase U.S. production in the U.S.
And the Department of Health and Human Services signed a nearly $2 billion contract today with Pfizer and a German-led biotech firm for the first 100 million doses of a potential virus vaccine by December. But the vaccine has not completed clinical trials, much less been FDA approved. Meanwhile, in the New York Times, Tom Frieden, the former director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, warned of critical data gaps in an opinion piece. And he said the government's lack of coordination is hampering efforts to stop COVID-19's spread. On the economic front, efforts continue at the Capitol to craft a new relief package. Senate Republicans remain divided on how much to spend and on what. But there is talk of a short-term extension of unemployment benefits. They're due to expire on July 31st. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
With more than 1,000 deaths reported yesterday, many states are struggling to contain COVID outbreaks. As we just heard in Stephanie's report, former CDC head Dr. Tom Frieden says to do that, the country urgently needs much better collection of data. Dr. Frieden joins me now. He ran the CDC from 2009 to 2017. He's now president of Resolve to Save Lives. It's a global health initiative. Dr. Frieden, thank you so much for talking with us. And before we talk about your plan, let me quickly ask you about the testing delays, which we are learning are an even bigger problem than we had realized a few months ago. What can be done about this?
It's really important to focus on what matters. There's been too much focus on the number of tests and not enough focus on whether they're being done in the right way, on the right people, with the right actions taken when they come back. There are different types of tests out there. The biggest problem are in the large commercial labs. Tests that come back 5, 6, 7 days, let alone 10 or 14 days, are of very little use. So if we hear there are 500,000 or 700,000 tests done, that's much less relevant than knowing what proportion of tests come back within 24 to 48 hours. We need to focus on what's important so we can improve our response.
Dr. Frieden, you are calling in your proposal for the states to do a much better job of reporting data, essential data on this coronavirus outbreak. What is it that is not available now that is needed, that we need to know?
Judy, what was really surprising in this analysis is that it's not the state's fault. There isn't a national standard. And the two crucial things that we don't have access to are, what is our personal risk of getting infected with COVID if we go out? And how well is our government and society doing in our community to reduce that risk? If we know those two things, we can focus and improve and get back or get to the new normal.
And what's it going to take to get that information? Is this easily gettable or not?
Some of it is. We identified 15 essential indicators. Of those 15, 9 are pretty easily achievable. Not very easily, but most places can get that, at least most of that, in some way. Some of it needs to be done much better in terms of race, ethnicity, age, other information on cases, hospitalizations, and deaths over time. So I think we can get some of that information fairly soon. But really, the more important information is about how well our response is going, whether tests are quick, whether patients are getting isolated promptly, whether contacts are being identified and quarantined before they develop the disease. These are the essential measures that we need to track and improve to be able to get our society and economy back. If we get this right, our kids will be able to go to school in the fall, will be able to go back to work, our economy will recover, and we'll save tens of thousands of lives. But if we're flying blind and we don't know how badly we're doing, we're not going to improve it.
I want to quote a doctor at Vanderbilt University who was quoted in the New York Times story today about your proposal. William Schaffner said he welcomes your proposals, but he says few states have the expertise and the money that's needed to generate this data, to analyze this data. He says it's a great ideal, but it's not something that many states can realistically do or realistically afford to do.
Well, Bill Schaffner is one of my favorite infectious disease experts, and he just about always gets it right. I think he's correct that states are looking at an enormous challenge. The data feeds coming in are complex. They're not necessarily accurate. There's a problem with duplicating patients. But the CDC has sent out more than $10 billion to state and local health departments, and Congress this week is debating the next supplemental appropriation. There's definitely a need for improved data systems all over, county, state, and federal. If we don't have those, it'll be hard to get this information. But many states have some of this information, and most states can get most of it.
I think some people are maybe listening to this, Dr. Frieden, and saying, wait a minute, if it's just a matter of asking questions, putting some information into a computer, it doesn't sound like it's that difficult. What do you say to that?
Well, one of the challenges is how heterogeneous our healthcare system and laboratory system is in this country. So one health department might be getting data in from hundreds or thousands of different providers in dozens or hundreds of different formats at different time frames. We, in my organization, Resolve to Save Lives, have worked with one state to streamline that information, deduplicate it. It's a big job. It's hard. Doesn't mean it can't be done or shouldn't be done. The other big part of this information is program information. And there, it's not just about information. It's about the job we're doing. Contact tracing, reaching patients, telling them they're infected, offering them services, getting them isolated. That requires a large number of highly trained people, disease investigators, interviewers, who have a combination of social work skills, medical knowledge, detective skills to find people, and counseling skills to support people with COVID and their contacts.
A spokesperson for the CDC is saying that we're already doing this. We are already in touch with the states to do what 14 of the 15 measurements that you're calling for. So they're saying they're almost there.
Well, what we see in the data from publicly available websites is that not a single state in the country had most of these indicators up. And most states in the country only had about a fifth of them available on their website. So we're a long way from where we need to go. But I do think that with pressure on states to put this information up and support to states from the federal government, from healthcare providers, from the community, and demands that we should know what's our risk and what's our response, we can see a lot of progress, and that can get us all on the same page. If we're all on the same page, we can improve our performance and begin to get the upper hand against COVID.
Dr. Tom Frieden, former director of the CDC, now with Resolve to Save Lives. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Judy.
In the day's other news, the U.S. ordered China to close its consulate in Houston by Friday, the latest move in an escalating campaign of pressure. The State Department cited concerns about espionage and intellectual property theft. We will look further into this story after the news summary. President Trump announced today that he is sending hundreds more federal agents to Chicago, Kansas City, and Albuquerque, New Mexico, to fight violent crime. They will be drawn from the FBI, the U.S. Marshals, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, and from the Department of Homeland Security. Local police will also receive millions of dollars in federal aid to hire more officers. In Chicago, Democratic Mayor Lori Lightfoot angrily dismissed the president's announcement as a political stunt. She also appealed for public help after 15 people were shot outside a funeral home on Tuesday. Officials say the shooter fired from a moving vehicle in a gang-related attack. The mayor called for an end to the bloodshed.
The senseless violence, this cycle of retaliation, picking up a gun, many times in petty grievances, picking up a gun that solves nothing but causes so much lifelong pain.
Separately, a federal judge today heard arguments over federal agents sent to Portland, Oregon. The state alleges that they have made illegal arrests and want an injunction. The Trump administration says their mission is defending federal property amid ongoing anti-racism protests. The U.S. House of Representatives voted today to remove a bust of Supreme Court Justice Roger Taney, who authored the infamous Dred Scott decision. In that 1857 case, Taney of Maryland upheld slavery and said blacks had no rights that whites had to respect. Today, his bust sits outside a room in the Capitol, where the court met for decades. But Democratic leader Steny Hoyer, also of Maryland, said it's time to promote the nation's true ideals.
what Dred Scott said was black lives did not matter. So when we assert that, yes, they do matter, it is out of conviction and conscience and appropriateness that in America, the land of the free and the home of the brave, that the land of the free include all of us.
A bust of Thurgood Marshall, a Maryland native and the first black Supreme Court justice, would replace the tawny image. The bill also calls for removing statues of pro-slavery or Confederate leaders, but it's not clear if the Senate will agree or if President Trump will sign it. The House also approved the Great American Outdoors Act today. The landmark legislation would pump nearly $2 billion a year into improving national parks, fighting climate change, and locating parks in inner cities. The bill already passed the Senate. It now goes to the president. In Israel, there were fresh protests overnight aimed at ousting Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. Clusters of demonstrators clashed with police outside Netanyahu's official residence. Officers said they arrested 34 people and broke up the gathering. Netanyahu is under fire for his response to COVID-19 and his trial on corruption charges. Twitter says that it is banning accounts and content linked to a far-right conspiracy theory. QAnon alleges that President Trump faces enemies in the so-called deep state. He, in turn, has promoted various QAnon posts. Twitter says that it is acting to bar any posts that could cause harm to others. And on Wall Street today, the Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 165 points to close at 27,005. The Nasdaq rose 25 points, and the S&P 500 added 18. Still to come on the NewsHour, the U.S. orders a Chinese consulate closed, alleging theft of data and intellectual property. Medical developers race against the clock as questions remain about delivery of an eventual vaccine. Drug overdoses increase dramatically as people struggling with addiction lose access to treatment, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
A global fight escalates again. Today's move to close the Chinese consulate in Houston is the latest action by the Trump administration against Beijing. Nick Schifrin reports on what is at stake.
In the courtyard of China's Houston consulate, Chinese staff in a hurry. They burned documents and drums last night after the administration ordered the consulate closed, citing a pattern of Chinese theft and espionage.
We are setting out clear expectations for how the Chinese Communist Party is going to behave. And when they don't, we're going to take actions that protect the American people.
Administration and intelligence officials tell PBS NewsHour the Chinese have used the Houston consulate as a hub for espionage. Just yesterday, the Department of Justice for the first time accused Chinese hackers of working for both personal gain and the Communist Party.
China has now taken its place alongside Russia, Iran, and North Korea in that shameful club of nations that provide a safe haven for cyber criminals in exchange for those criminals being on call for the benefit of the state.
But senior officials tell PBS NewsHour today was also about diplomatic reciprocity. In January, out of fears of COVID, the U.S. evacuated its Wuhan consulate. It has not reopened because of a dispute over whether U.S. employees have to quarantine and take COVID-19 tests upon arrival at Chinese airports. Longer term, U.S. officials say they want to reduce their footprint in China. In addition to the Beijing embassy, the U.S. has five consulates on the Chinese mainland and the Hong Kong consulate. Senior officials say they've accepted the likely permanent closure of one consulate and intend to move it elsewhere in Asia. Foreign Ministry spokesman Wang Wangbin warned of that likely closure today.
China strongly condemns the decision and urges the U.S. side to immediately recall the wrong decision. Otherwise, China will take legitimate and necessary countermeasures.
Publicly, Chinese diplomats emphasize mutual respect and criticize U.S. policy as self-defeating. Foreign Minister Wang Yi gave a major speech on July the 9th.
The current China policy of the U.S. is based on ill-informed strategic miscalculation and is fraught with emotions and whims and McCarthyist bigotry. Its suspicion about China, which is totally uncalled for, has reached a point of paranoia.
But the administration is clear it will continue to target and penalize China until behavior changes. After Beijing passed legislation that restricted Hong Kong's freedoms, President Trump signed a bill that allowed new sanctions.
Thank you very much, everybody.
And then a series of speeches. National Security Advisor Robert O'Brien on the ideology of the Chinese Communist Party, or CCP.
The CCP's stated goal is to create a community of common destiny for mankind and to remake the entire world according to the CCP.
FBI Director Christopher Wray.
If you're an American adult, it is more likely than not that China has stolen your personal data.
And Attorney General William Barr.
The ultimate ambition of China's rulers isn't to trade with the United States. It is to raid the United States.
U.S.-China relations are at their lowest point since relations began in 1979. Take the case of Houston.
The eyes of Texas were on Deng Xiaoping today.
In 1979, then-Chinese leader Deng Xiaoping visited the city and the Johnson Space Center. Houston was the first Chinese consulate in the U.S. But while some China watchers worry about the confrontation, the Trump administration says it's overdue.
For an awful long time, our policy simply reflected allowing China to engage in behavior that was radically unreciprocal, enormously unfair to the American people, and frankly put America's national security at risk. And so we have begun to turn that around.
And we explore today's decision and overall U.S.-China policy with Susan Thornton. She had a 28-year career as an American diplomat focusing on Asia. She's now a visiting lecturer at Yale Law School. And Gordon Chang lived and worked in mainland China and Hong Kong for nearly two decades, where he practiced law. His latest book is The Great U.S.-China Tech War. Welcome, both of you, to the NewsHour. Susan Thornton, let me begin with you. Do you believe the closure of the Chinese consulate in Houston is in U.S. interests?
I would just put this in context to begin with and note that, you know, closure of a consulate outside of wartime is an exceedingly rare move in diplomacy. So I guess, this is the only unilateral closure of a U.S. consulate that I'm aware of other than the Russian San Francisco consulate in 2017, which was a very different circumstance and involved a lot of discussions with the Russians ahead of time. I think, you know, many other countries share our concerns about China, the challenges that it poses to international law and order and to our economic competitiveness. But this kind of action gives the impression of recklessness, and it's not really clear to me what it accomplishes.
Gordon Chang, recklessness and not clear what it accomplishes. Do you believe the closure was in U.S. interests?
Yeah, I certainly believe that this was the right thing to do. The State Department talked about protecting U.S. intellectual property, and the Houston consulate is known as a hub for espionage. We've been talking to China about hacking and all the rest of these things for about three decades, and yet we haven't gotten anywhere. We had the agreement with Chinese leader Xi Jinping in September 2015 for countries not to hack each other for commercial purposes. We had the Section 301 tariffs that were supposed to be a remedy for the theft of U.S. intellectual property. But China has continued to steal U.S. IP in the hundreds of billions of dollars a year. Yes, you could say this is unfortunate, closing the consulate, but we had to do something to try to get China to stop this dangerous activity.
Susan Thornton, as we just laid out in the piece that aired right before we started, there have been a series of speeches by U.S. administration officials laying out some of the concerns, including the ones that Gordon just mentioned. Do you believe that kind of rhetoric is helpful toward achieving what the U.S. is trying to do with China?
Well, I think from where I sit, the real problem is that we need a very nuanced and thoughtful strategy to take on the very complicated challenge that China presents. And right now, it seems like we have a tough attitude and a lot of provocative measures that don't account for a strategy and don't have any clear accomplishments. I mean, our trade balance is worse than it was when we started this so-called China strategy. Our position in the Asia Pacific has deteriorated. And I think a lot of countries are looking at what we're doing and not sure that we have that kind of clear strategy thought through. And I think I'll just associate myself with the words of a pretty wise elder statesman I heard yesterday, who said that in this competition, if China comes out on top, it'll be because things happened in the U.S., not because of things that happened in China.
Gordon Chang, respond to those arguments that Susan Thornton sees a tough attitude but no strategy and actually negative consequences to U.S. decisions.
Well, I know Susan talked about a thoughtful and nuanced strategy, and that certainly sounds good to the ear. The problem is we've had thoughtful and nuanced strategies for decades, and while we've done this, China has not moved in the right directions. You know, we had hoped to integrate China into the international system, that it would enmesh itself and would become benign. But unfortunately, China has moved in very belligerent and provocative directions, and so we need to change strategy. Now, this strategy is pretty young, and I can understand her comments that it doesn't seem like it's working, but I actually do believe that it is. But in any event, I don't think we had any choice but to try something different, because what we've been doing for decades just wasn't working.
Susan Thornton, if I could ask specifically about what the Trump administration has done and has done something different, as Gordon Chang just put it, new visa requirements on state-sponsored Chinese reporters, sanctioned individuals deemed responsible for the crackdown in Xinjiang, extended bans on the Chinese telecommunications company Huawei, stated China's South China Sea claims are without merit, began to punish China over Hong Kong, etc. There's actually a longer list. Do you believe that those decisions, some of those decisions, have been the right ones?
Look, Nick, I don't want to get into every single decision and the merits and demerits of it, and we don't have time. But what I would say is that the U.S. serves a special role in the world because of our values and our example. And in many of these measures, what we are doing in pursuing reciprocity with China is that we're going down into the ditch with China, and we're trying to see who can go lower. And I think at the end of the day, the Chinese are going to win that fight. And I don't think it's a fight worthy of the United States. We have always maintained the openness of our society as a positive attribute. We have been confident in our foreign policy and in our economic competitiveness, and I think we should remain so. And I think we can beat China on that kind of a strategy and not this kind of provocation after provocation and going into the ditch with them. That's my view.
Gordon Chang, when I ask senior U.S. administration officials what their goal is, it is to, as you know, change Chinese behavior, both short-term and long-term. Do you think that's possible?
It may be very difficult because China's brand of communism, I think, is not capable of reform. You know, we have tried to do that for five decades, and we have not achieved the results that everybody was hoping for. And we very well may have to decide with regard to China the same decisions that were made in the 1940s and 1950s with regard to the Soviet Union, that this was a competition which unfortunately was a zero-sum game. It was China's existential challenge to the United States. And if we're going to defend ourselves, it's not going into the ditch with China. It's actually trying to preserve our way of life, our freedom, our economy. And we are going to have to take measures that will cost us. We cannot think that we can engage in five decades of misguided policy and not end up costing ourselves as we try to extricate the United States and the international system.
Gordon Chang, Susan Thornton, two sides of this debate. Thank you very much to you both.
It might be the most pressing question in the world. When will we have a COVID vaccine? This week has seen a number of headlines on this front. And today, the Trump administration awarded a nearly $2 billion contract to Pfizer and a German biotech firm to potentially deliver 100 million doses by the end of the year. There have also been early but encouraging results from other trials. Miles O'Brien is here to help sort through it all for our reporting on the leading edge of science. So, Miles, hello to you. You've been spending a lot of time on this. Tell us, how soon is it thought that we might have a vaccine, and how much vaccine are these companies that are developing them promising?
Judy, it's just unprecedented when you think about it. Here we are about 6 months since the Chinese published the genetic code of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, the novel coronavirus. And currently, there are about 140 vaccine ideas, not in human trials, and about two dozen in the midst of human trials. Now, yesterday on Capitol Hill, representatives of three of the big pharma companies testified before Congress and indicated they are prepared to begin mass testing on humans to see if these vaccines are effective by the end of the year. And I can tell you, no one would have predicted this 6 months ago.
If they're moving this quickly, though, Miles, how do we know that they're not cutting corners?
Well, they are cutting corners, but they say not on safety. What they're doing, Judy, which is kind of clever and risky, is they're manufacturing vaccines that they are currently testing. The idea is if they go through the trials and they're effective and they're protective and they get the green light, the pump will be primed. And if not, if they don't work, they'll just have to incinerate and just take that risk. Now, members of the Congress on that committee are concerned that there might be pressure on the FDA, political pressure, to green light a vaccine that may not be protective enough sometime this fall, perhaps even before the election. The bar set by the FDA is 50%. That means at least 50% of the people who are inoculated would have some defenses against this novel coronavirus. Now, here's a short excerpt from the committee chairman, Frank Pallone, Democrat of New Jersey. He's chairman of the House Committee on Energy and Commerce, along with Makaya Duwogi, who is with Johnson & Johnson.
I want you to kind of assume what unfortunately shouldn't happen, which is, you know that the FDA is approving the drug, even though it's only 10 or 20% effective. Will you tell us that? Do you feel an obligation to tell us that and give us that information?
We would design our trial actually to target the efficacy that's outlined in our target product profile. The study would fail if it hit 10%. We would make those results available, but we would not feel comfortable bringing forward a product that did not that was not found to be efficacious according to what we put forth in our protocol.
One advantage in all of this, Judy, is the nature of science. It is an open enterprise, and transparency is what it's all about. And if there was an attempt to make any of this secret, it's hard to overstate the hue and cry from researchers. And the other thing is, too, if people are going to confidently take these vaccines, you need transparency so they understand what's in them and what the side effects might be.
So Miles, what is the latest information in these peer-reviewed journals, and is there reason for optimism?
In a word, yes. There were three papers that dropped early this week, two of them peer-reviewed in the British journal The Lancet from the Oxford AstraZeneca team, CanSino team, and then some preliminary results from the Pfizer BioNTech team. And in all cases, no serious side effects, you know, aches and fever, that sort of thing that you might get after a vaccine, but nothing serious, nothing adverse. And here's the key thing. They have all generated what appears to be a pretty solid immune response with antibodies, which they go after the virus itself, and T cells, which are in our blood system, and they are designed to go after the cells that have been infected with the virus and kill them. So all these vaccines are in a position to go to what they call phase three trials, meaning large numbers of people, to see if they're protective enough. We're talking about studies of 30,000 people or so, and that will determine if the vaccine is good enough to be released to the public.
And Miles, when we talk about dosages that people would receive, we're talking about two doses of a vaccine per person. Is that right?
Yes. So far, those three contenders we're talking about and the ones that are at the later stages, all, it appears, would require two doses, which, of course, complicates things. We're talking about, after all, potentially the entire planet needing it, 7 billion people times two. That's a huge supply chain issue, to say the least. This brings us to an important point. We don't know how long the antibodies effect, the T cells effect, the immune response will last. There is no way to do a shortcut on the long-term efficacy of these vaccines. Chemist Derek Lowe is a veteran new drug investigator, and he is the editor of a very influential blog called In the Pipeline.
There is nothing in those papers, and there is no way there could be anything, because that is one of the major unsolved questions in vaccine work and in immunology in general, is how long immune memory lasts and why it lasts longer in some cases. We are just going to have to wait it out and keep an eye on it and say, okay, we are now recommending a booster at the 2-year level or whatever. Or we may have another vaccine by then we like better. But there is no other way now than to just wait and see. It's frustrating, but that's the state of the art.
And the same goes for safety too, Judy. There is no way to do a shortcut on that. There could be some long-term effects of these vaccines. It's highly unlikely. But researchers say, given the global pandemic and the emergency surrounding it, this is probably worth the risk.
So it does sound promising, but Miles, what is known about how much this is going to cost and who's going to pay for it all?
Well, the taxpayers are funneling a lot of money right now. All of us are funneling into this warp speed program to fund some of this. But the question is, how will the dosages be paid for at the other end? At the congressional hearing yesterday, executives from Pfizer, Moderna, and Merck said they would, in fact, be seeking a profit on these vaccines. But AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson said they would deliver the vaccines, if they were successful, to the government at cost. Presumably, they would be distributed for free. But, of course, the key thing here is, how do you determine what cost is, Judy?
Wow. Something that everybody is interested in. Miles O'Brien, following the vaccine story. Miles, thank you.
You're welcome, Judy.
Drug overdoses killed nearly 72,000 Americans last year, a record high, according to preliminary data released last week by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. It now appears that 2020 is on track to be even worse, as the nation has seen a startling rise in overdoses just in the last few months. William Brangham examines what could be behind these disturbing numbers.
In early April, like so many Americans, 31-year-old Sarah Whitner was struggling with the new realities of life during the pandemic. So she called up her dad, Leon.
When the pandemic started, she asked if she could come live with us because she wanted that family support. She knew that the worst thing for her to do during this pandemic was to sit at home alone.
I spoke with Leon and Sarah's sister, Grace, via Skype near their home in Broomfield, Colorado. They told me that Sarah had struggled with addiction for 8 years. It started when she was prescribed opioids after she had surgery on her ear in 2012. But prior to the pandemic, she'd seemingly turned a corner. She was working at a local health association and was planning her wedding in the fall.
I wasn't as worried about Sarah now than I was about her in the past.
The family says Sarah completed multiple treatment programs in recent years, including 30 days of inpatient treatment in January. She was also regularly attending Narcotics Anonymous meetings.
In addition, she would just be able to call a friend and go get coffee and have that one-on-one connection. And that was extremely helpful to her. So all of those things combined, I think, really helped her sobriety. And then that was completely gone when the pandemic hit.
Sarah was also told there would be a delay in her medically assisted treatment. She was taking monthly shots of Vivitrol, which is a drug that helps block people's cravings for opioids.
She normally had a 30-day appointment to have the Vivitrol shot, which is what the time is that it really is effective for. And because of the pandemic, they pushed all the appointments out, and her appointment ended up being at 45 days. Instead of 30, and that.
So normally she would get a shot every month, pretty regularly,
yes.
Every 30-day window. But then the pandemic stops that normal process.
Yeah, it added 15 days onto that process, and that 15 days were a tough 15 days for her.
That delay, her dad says, led to Sarah relapsing. On April 16th, one day before her next Vivitrol shot, Sarah was found by her sister Grace, unresponsive in her bedroom, a syringe in her hand. Sarah died. Her dad believes it was an overdose of fentanyl, the powerful synthetic opioid.
She passed away on Thursday morning, and the real unfortunate piece for us is her doctor's appointment for the shot was Friday. So it was like she was going to make it to that one last time, I'll be fine. And then I'll get to the doctor and I'll be okay.
Tragically, Sarah Whitner's story is becoming more common across the U.S. While overdoses were already on the rise before the start of the pandemic, the public health crisis is only making matters worse. Drug-related deaths have risen, on average, by 13% so far this year, according to data collected from both local and state governments. And the American Medical Association recently reported that 39 states have seen a spike in opioid-related overdoses. In some places, like Cook County, Illinois, which includes Chicago, opioid overdose deaths have doubled since last year. In nearby DuPage County, they are up by a third, according to coroner Richard Jorgensen.
When I look through these deaths, overwhelmingly, these are people that lived alone, that were having financial difficulties, marital difficulties, previous problems with addiction or mental health problems. So these are the very needy of our society. And what do they need? They need community.
Addiction is a disease of isolation, and no one chooses to have addiction any more so than someone chooses to have diabetes or multiple sclerosis.
Dr. Caleb Alexander is a professor of epidemiology and medicine at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. He says another effect of the pandemic has been a massive disruption to the illegal drug market.
You know, if you think about the ways that the pandemic has ground the economy to a halt, that's occurred in the illicit drug markets as well. So, for example, it's decreased the transport of drugs across borders, but it's also disrupted local drug markets and introduced much greater uncertainty regarding what substances are what, and how individuals that do have opioid addiction can find those. And this is one of the reasons that the increased mortality rates that many states have reported due to fentanyl are so concerning.
Alexander says in normal times, a disruption in the illegal drug market would likely help funnel more people into treatment. But for many facing substance abuse disorders, access to treatment has also been disrupted by the pandemic.
Because of social distancing, you can't have as many people. In an inpatient facility where you may have had two or three people to a room, now you only have one. Or in some of the group situations, you're also having much smaller groups.
Chuck Ingolia is the president of the National Council for Behavioral Health, which represents more than 3,000 treatment organizations around the country. Ingolia says fewer patients has meant less revenue this year, and more than 40% of the organizations he represents could be out of money in 6 months.
At a time when more people will be experiencing depression, anxiety, and/or substance use disorders, it's the last thing we need to do is to lose facilities.
President Trump has often cited both the rise in suicides and drug use as a reason to open up the economy quickly.
We have to get our country back. You know, people are dying the other way, too. When you look at what's happened with drugs, it goes up. When you look at suicides, I mean, take a look at what's going on. People are losing their jobs.
But of the roughly $3 trillion in relief funds that Congress has given out since the beginning of the pandemic, only a fraction of 1% has been designated for mental health and substance abuse treatment. Back in March, the federal government relaxed some of the barriers around the prescription and dispensing of the most commonly used medications to treat opioid addiction. For example, methadone clinics can now prescribe up to 4 weeks of the medication at a time rather than requiring daily visits.
Well, I can get you that information, so that maybe can make things a little bit easier for you.
But for those on the front lines of the addiction crisis, the toll gets worse every day.
I probably personally know of 11 people who overdosed in the last 3 months.
Jen Cutting is in recovery from heroin and methamphetamines and now works as a certified peer recovery coach in upstate New York. She says both the pandemic and the government's response to it has upended life for the people she cares for.
It's a cluster, to be quite frank. And, you know, you go and you take people who are already closed off and operate in a very, very small circle and then tell them they can't even have that circle. And they're like, and on top of it, here's $1,200 and see you later. Bye.
This is the unemployment or the government's, the check people are getting.
The unemployment and the stimulus all came at one time. You have people who are struggling with their sobriety. You gave them a boatload of cash and told them to stay in their home and don't do anything. So imagine if the entire country was on a diet that couldn't eat chocolate, and then all of a sudden they were putting chocolate out on the street.
Back in Colorado, Leon and Grace Whitner say they've been shocked at how many people have reached out to them with similar tragic stories.
The numbers of people that I've come in contact with that have lost a loved one to either overdose or suicide during this pandemic is staggering.
Are you convinced that if it were not for this pandemic, that Sarah would still be alive today?
Had she have just gotten her shot at 30 days, she would still be planning her wedding with Grace right now. She'd be at her job working. It's no one's fault, but we have to find a way to fix that because it's a terrible loss of an amazing person.
The Whitners say they plan to hold a funeral for Sarah this Saturday in Broomfield, Colorado. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham.
On Tuesday, President Trump signed a memo that aims to bar undocumented immigrants from being included in the census count that determines how many members of Congress are allocated for each state. Lisa Desjardins explores what it means.
The 2020 census is a once-in-a-decade feat, a count of the U.S. population that will affect policy and power for years. But it faces unprecedented challenges, from the pandemic itself to political debate over how it should be run, including the president's latest memo. Joining me to help understand all of this is NPR's Hanzi Lo Wang. Hanzi, thank you so much. And let me start right off with the president's move. Help us understand it. Can the president, in fact, block the census from counting undocumented immigrants?
Well, I think the thing to take a look at is the Constitution. Let's take a look at the actual text of the Constitution. The 14th Amendment of the Constitution, the actual text says, representatives shall be apportioned among the several states according to their respective numbers, counting the whole number of persons in each state. And it's the whole number of persons because the 14th Amendment was enacted after the Civil War, after the ending of counting of enslaved person as 3/4 of a person. And, you know, more than 200 years, the country has included both citizens and non-citizens, regardless of immigration status, in the population counts that determine how seats are divided up in Congress. So President Trump would be going up against more than two centuries of precedent, and also another part of the Constitution that says it is Congress, not the president, who has the final authority about the count.
You know, we at NewsHour, myself and a lot of our politics team, love talking about the census, and it's because it's so important. Can you just remind folks what's at stake here? Why does the census matter so much?
It matters because when you're talking about the census, you are really talking about power and you're talking about money. And this is the power and money of the people living in the United States. This is how the country determines how it distributes an estimated $1.5 trillion, with a T, a year in federal tax dollars from Medicare, from Medicaid, other public services, how that gets divvied up to local communities. This also determines how many congressional seats and electoral college votes each state gets. And this is data that informs how voting districts are redrawn once every 10 years after the census is counted. So this has impacts on the balance of power from local government all the way up to federal government.
You know, there's another political storm around the census as well. The president has appointed a new deputy director for policy and an assistant to that person. Some in the statistics community say they're not qualified. Can you talk about that appointment and why it is controversial?
The Trump administration, they've made these two brand new appointments, two new top-level positions that never existed before at the Census Bureau. A deputy director of policy, Nathaniel Cogley, a political science professor, he's being appointed at a time where there already is a deputy director at the Census Bureau, and it's still unclear to me and to the public exactly what does Nathaniel Cogley, this deputy director of policy, what he does at the Census Bureau, and also what his senior advisor, Adam Korzenewski, what he does. Both of them have qualifications that don't seem to quite match with what the Census Bureau does. It's a federal statistical agency focused on survey methodology, statistics, economics. Both of these appointees don't seem to have much of that background based on their resumes.
And then we come to the public health crisis itself. Let's look at a map quickly. This is a map of the Americans who have responded themselves to the census. The darker states have the higher response rate. On average, just over 60% of Americans have responded. But Hunzi, by my account, that leaves over 100 million people at least that the census still has to contact. Where is the agency right now on completing the census on time?
The Census Bureau has a big job to do. About 4 out of 10 homes have not been counted yet, and it has given itself until October 31st to try to complete this count. It is trying to send out door knockers to do in-person interviews with households, because at this point of the census, historically, these are households that are less likely to fill out a form on their own. It will require convincing and person-to-person interaction, and that is a big challenge at a time where we're all trying to keep social distance. There are a lot of public health concerns, and there are some parts of the country that are under lockdown and may be under lockdown when door knocking is supposed to roll out nationwide on August 11th.
Hanzi Lo Wong, our eye on the census, thank you for all of your work on this.
You're very welcome.
Four years ago, the Chester Children's Chorus, a group based near Philadelphia, recorded an original song called I Still Can't Breathe. It was their response to the deaths of Trayvon Martin, Eric Garner, and others. The chorus members have since grown to be teenagers and young adults. Now, as Black Lives Matter protests continue across the country in the wake of George Floyd's death, these young people see their song as tragically still relevant. Their story comes as part of our ongoing arts and culture series, Canvas.
When we performed I Still Can't Breathe, I was around 10, 11 years old. When I hear the song now, there's a huge sense of deja vu.
4 years ago, I was a kid singing this song. Now I'm an adult and I'm a grown man, and the same things are happening.
It's literal. It's also a repeat of the words of Eric Garner's last words before his life was taken from him. And it's also a metaphor for the Black experience in America.
The song is talking to those people who are constantly denying that there is a thing such as racism.
There is a sense of hope because there are young kids singing it, but there's also a sense of helplessness, also because there are young kids singing it. Young Black children realize what's going on, and some adults don't know what's going on or refuse to believe what's going on.
People coming away thinking what a beautiful song that is. Why should we be hearing Black men begging through a choke, I can't breathe? Why should they be pleading?
Why are you afraid of me?
What's different is that the pandemic has given many white Americans the time and the emotional space to think about something more important than going shopping or going to a movie or going out to a restaurant. So all of the distractions have been taken away from us.
This new generation that is coming up, we have the power to change things. We have very large voices, and people are just now starting to listen.
And we need to listen to these young people. On the NewsHour online right now, we have answers to some of your COVID-19 questions, including how to clean your mask. Our essential FAQ is on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
When the world gets complicated, a lot goes through your mind. With Fidelity Wealth Management, a dedicated advisor can tailor advice and recommendations to your life. That's Fidelity Wealth Management.
Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.